United States Coast Guard, the Commandant, in recognition of notable services which have assisted greatly in furthering the aims and functions of the Coast Guard, takes pleasure in presenting the Meritorious Public Service Award to Mr. Jody Jordan, executed this first day of April, 1989, signed P.A. Yost, Admiral, U.S. Coast Guard Commandant. The Meritorious Public Service Award to Mr. Jody Jordan for his extraordinary personal heroism and direct contribution on the evening of November 14, 1988, to the successful rescue of three men from the capsized and grounded fishing vessel Judy and Betsy, with wind and water temperatures in the 40s, an onshore wind and falling tide, Mr. Jordan launched his skiff to assist the Coast Guard in rescuing the three fishermen off Trundy Reef, Trundy Point, Cape Elizabeth, Maine, maneuvering alongside Coast Guard utility boat CG-41371 that was constrained by draft to reach the wrecked fishing vessel. Mr. Jordan took aboard two rescue swimmers and proceeded to push, pull, and float his skiff 200 yards to the wreck. Fighting 2 to 5 foot breakers, flotsam, and darkness, the three men were pulled aboard and the skiff headed for open water. Once clear of the wreck, a rogue wave washed over the skiff, requiring furious hand bailing to remain afloat. Demonstrating exceptional small boat seamanship, Mr. Jordan was able to reach the waiting Coast Guard boat and transfer the rescued victims. Given the length of time exposed to the elements and rapidly deteriorating conditions of the wrecked vessel, it is evident that Mr. Jordan's quick and decisive actions, coupled with his local knowledge and seamanship, enabled three people to be rescued without serious injury. By placing his own life on par with unknown people in distress, Mr. Jordan has demonstrated humanity in its purest form, and his actions are hereby recognized by presentation of the Coast Guard Meritorious Public Service Award and accompanying medal.
Jordy, if you'll come up here, please.
The Department of Transportation, United States Coast Guard, Public Service Commendation. In recognition of notable services which have assisted greatly in furthering the aims and functions of the Coast Guard, this certificate is awarded to the Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies, Cape Elizabeth, Maine, executed this 8th day of February, 1989, at the 1st Coast Guard District Office, Boston, Massachusetts. Signed for the Commandant, R.I. Rybacki, Rear Admiral, U.S. Coast Guard, Commander, 1st Coast Guard District. Public Service Commendation to the Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies, Cape Elizabeth, Maine. The Commander, 1st Coast Guard District, takes great pleasure in presenting the United States Coast Guard Public Service Commendation to the Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies, Cape Elizabeth, Maine, for their part in the rescue of three fishermen on Trundy Reef off Trundy Point, Cape Elizabeth, Maine. On the evening of 14 November 1988, members of the Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies demonstrated exceptional courage and initiative while assisting in the rescue of three men from the grounded and capsized fishing vessel Judy and Betsy. This near-shore grounding and subsequent wreck occurred 2 hours after sunset during ebb tide in 47-degree water with 2 to 5 foot breaking waves at the seam. Air temperature was 43 degrees. The three men on the wrecked vessel were not wearing exposure suits nor personal flotation devices. The Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies responded from shoreside to this emergency. Two of their volunteer members, wearing survival suits, attempted to reach the vessel, only to be forced back repeatedly by pounding surf. However, another firefighter, using his skiff, carried Coast Guard rescue swimmers to the stricken vessel and effected a successful rescue. During the rescue, the Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Companies stood by shoreside with lights and numerous pieces of rescue equipment, including two fully staffed ambulances. The Cape Elizabeth Fire and Rescue Company's quick action, initiative, and support of the Coast Guard contributed directly to the saving of three lives. Their unhesitating response and selfless courage in assisting these mariners in distress is heartily commended and are in keeping with the highest traditions of public service. Chief Webster.
As Chief of the Department, and on behalf of all the fire and rescue personnel, I would like to thank Captain Underwood and the United States Coast Guard for recognizing the terrific effort that these people put in that evening down on Trundy Point under some very adverse weather conditions. I would especially like to recognize Doug Tinsman, Russ Bazankin, for their efforts in trying to get a line aboard the vessel that evening, and also Dick Tinsman and Mike Jordan for their shore support efforts. I must say it was a combined effort between Jody and the Coast Guard and the shore personnel that made this rescue effort the success that it was. And I think the town of Cape Elizabeth should be very proud of these people. Thank you.
I would just like to conclude by also thanking very, very much the Coast Guard for making these acknowledgments, taking the time and energy to make these public acknowledgments, and also, of course, a special thanks to our citizens who've brought great honor onto themselves and onto our town as well. So we're very, very appreciative of your heroic efforts. Thank you. And now the town council meeting, which I hope is not anticlimactic after this excellent ceremony. I would now like to call to order the town council meeting of May 22nd, 1989, and begin, as we do all town council meetings, by asking Deborah Pizzo, our town clerk, to please call the roll.
Frank Latore.
Present.
Jane Amaro.
Here.
Phyllis Cogsall.
Here.
Wayne Krillman.
Here.
Janet Greenlaw.
Here.
William Jordan.
Here.
Nancy Masterton.
Here.
Thank you very much. We begin tonight's agenda with citizens' discussion of items that are not on the agenda, and this is every town council meeting, we have two periods of time that are put aside for citizens to come forward to discuss items that might not appear on our agenda this evening. We do so at the beginning of each meeting. We also do so at the end of each meeting for timing purposes. So at this time, is there anyone that would care to come forward to discuss an item not already on our printed agenda? If not, I would proceed to our next item, which is reports and correspondence. I would ask if any of my fellow councilors that represent us in different forums or have any correspondence that they'd like to share with us. And I see Councilor Jordan ready
yes,
for a report.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to add something to what was just presented to the Cape Rescue and also Jody Jordan. As Jody would say, nothing to it. What has come out of that is a rescue team, water extrication rescue team. And in that, they have got some very able individuals that are really come forward to help out. There's fishermen, and there's police department. There's the police department is kind of the police chief is kind of is the head of it at this point. And there's Coast Guard reserves, volunteer firemen and rescue. There's a vice president of a major Southern Maine firm, and there's also a stockbroker, the news station, and CE teaching staff have worked with them very closely as far as the pool and what have you to do their training. So I think that we owe a great contribution to the people that have really come forward and volunteered their services as far as putting this team together.
Very true. Are there other reports and correspondence from any of my fellow councilors that they care to me? Yes, Councilor Greenlee.
Frank, I just wanted to thank everybody who showed up Saturday for the Fort Williams Cleanup Day. There were between 40 and 50 people at Fort Williams. When you spread people out over that large an expanse, you don't realize perhaps how much work gets done, but a lot of work did get done. And I especially want to acknowledge Neil Williams, who drove the trash truck to and from the dump on a number of runs, Steve Edsel, who was responsible for organizing the Rotary to be there with coffee and donuts, which were much appreciated and helped get some people going. Phil Jewett, who is an eighth grade teacher at our middle school and the student council advisor. He was there with some seventh and eighth grade students who did a super job. And the Fort Williams committee, especially Ann Kerner, who headed up the effort on Saturday. And I think unbeknownst to us, we were not only getting it ready for ourselves, but getting it ready for a quick afternoon visit by Mrs. Bush and Mrs. Mitterrand. And that's one of the places on the itinerary. And we did a good job that morning. I hope more people will join us the next time we do it. And I commend the people who showed up. I hope the rest of you will go enjoy the fort. Keep in mind that we'll need your help for the next cleanup day next year.
Thank you. And congratulations on the good timing of the year award for that one, as a matter of fact. I have received a letter from the White House Commission on Presidential Scholars that I'd like to share with everyone this evening, addressed to the Council Chairman LaTorre. The White House and its Commission on Presidential Scholars have announced the names of the 1989 U.S. Presidential Scholars. Andrew B. Russ, son of Joel and Carolyn Russ, who reside at 28 Rocky Hill Road, is one of 141 outstanding young Americans designated as U.S. Presidential Scholar, the nation's highest honor bestowed upon graduating high school seniors. There were nearly 3 million graduating high school seniors this year. So we wish to certainly congratulate Andrew Russ and his parents and everyone at the high school connected with Andrew. It's a great honor for himself and once again for the town. And I just wanted to publicly acknowledge this for Andrew and his very proud, rightfully proud parents. One other note that I would like to make is once again offering congratulations to Reverend Burgess and his congregation of the Cape Elizabeth Church of the Nazarene for their dedicating ceremonies that they had yesterday, capping off about 9 months of renovations of their church. I was invited to come and represent the town and was happy to bring greetings on behalf of the town, the entire town. And I was most pleased the way I'm always very hospitably received over there. But I also think it's a fantastic job that they've done. It's pretty much of an open house situation there. If any of you would like to go in and see the incredible things that they've uncovered in redoing this church, which is over 130 years old, and the way they have restored it is a thing of beauty. So I wanted to thank Reverend Burgess and the whole congregation for the way they treated me yesterday. Outstanding event. If there's no further reports or correspondence, I'd like to move on to items 150 through 154, including some public hearings that go along with these. And at this time, I would like to turn it over to a person that we all feel did an outstanding job as the chairman of the Finance Committee this year, Councilor Bill Jordan.
I don't know about that. It went out.
I felt that way anyway.
Okay, thank you. No, I just want to point out and say that the council did review the budget, reviewed it very thoroughly, and met with each one of the department heads and the school department. And I'm just going to throw out some of the increases that were involved. And then after that, if anybody has any questions, they inquire them between myself and manager, and we have the department heads here, possibly that we can get an answer for you. Some of the increases that we had no control over was, like, the county budget was up approximately 30%. Insurances, health, and other insurances were up approximately 20%. And that isn't what we have any control over. We just have to write the ticket for those increases. And also, there was a utility man at the public safety building for 28 hours for this last year. And due to some of the complaints as far as dog control, he did spend some time on dog control, but we feel now that it isn't adequate, and maybe it should be boosted up a little bit. So we have increased that 28-hour week job to a 40-hour week job, which will give him more time as far as dog control is concerned. And also within the police department, we hate to add personnel to any budget because that's where the costs are, but sometimes you have to do those things. So police department, we've added an investigator, and the chief is here to answer any technical questions and what have you, but he convinced us that it was needed, that they didn't really have the time with the personnel that they have now to follow up the complaints and really do a real thorough investigation on all of the complaints. And they have to kind of pick and choose them now. Also, in the police department, they're updating the computer system within the department, and that was an added approximately about $16,000 to do that. Also, in the library, in the children's area, and also the rest of the library is a computer to help time involved as far as receiving and sending out books and what's available. And they really pleaded hard, and we felt that it would be a benefit and would cut down a lot of time involved as far as issuing out books and returning the books. Also, in Fort Williams, we set up on a two-year project as far as one of the bigger projects as far as a fort is concerned, is fixing up the cement bleachers there. And part of them is going to be done this year, and that represents around $32,000. Another increase that come along, which is sizable in our opinion, is the tipping fees, and that's what it costs to haul your stuff to the transfer station, is going up $5 a ton. And that is something that they come back and say it's going up, and there's not much we can do about it. But I think there's going to be someone be looking into these tipping fees, because they're, as far as just within our town with iron and metals and what have you, they used to pay you and come and get it. Then they changed it, and they would come get it and not pay you anything. Now you've got to pay them to take it away. And I think they figure they got us where they want us, and I think that whole area of cost has got to be really looked into. And then there's $60,000 in here with the acquisition of open space land, if anything comes along, and to help connect the green belt to which was adopted by the council here a little while ago. And there's pieces in between there that needs to be picked up to tie it together. So those are just some of the highlights as far as the municipal budget goes that we picked up and reviewed and increased along the way. That's all I have for right now.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would then like to throw open the public hearing on fiscal year 1990 budget, the combined budget, municipal and school. At this time, would anyone care to come forward to comment on the fiscal year 1990 combined budget?
I just have a question.
Oh, could you? Yes, could you go to the microphone and?
I think you can hear me.
They can't.
They can't at home.
They like that reflection.
I'll wait till election day, Billy. I just have a question on the increase of the police utility person from 28 to 40 hours. I was curious whether or not that job is going to be advertised on the open market.
Yes. Unless the chief wants to add something to it, I understood at the time it would be.
Thank you. Any further discussion on the fiscal year 1990 budget? If not, I close.
You're really quick.
Oh, that's okay. I don't mean to gavel.
Look at that, right? I'm like Henry. I'm not used to this high-tech stuff either.
I can roll back the tape on that. I never bang that gavel.
My name is Ed Myers. I have one question for the school department representatives. Could you tell me what the enrollment is currently, K through 12?
Approximately 1,500, we expect about the same.
That's essentially the same as it was 4 years ago?
However, it's larger on the elementary level.
Yeah.
Less
than that. Well, given that static enrollment, I find it rather amazing that according to the budgets I've been looking at every spring, expenditures have gone up about 40% in the last 4 years. I'm sure there are a lot of good reasons for that, but I think that it's something that needs to be given some consideration. We've been fortunate that the tax base has been growing. The tax rate has not been growing at an excessive rate. Someday this might level off. And it's a heck of a lot harder to cut expenses than it is to add them on. So keep it in mind, please.
Further discussion on the fiscal year 1990 budget. I'm nowhere near my gavel, so feel free. If not, I would close the public hearing portion of item 150 and move on to item 150, which is to consider public hearing comments on the adoption of the fiscal year 1990 municipal school budget and take any necessary action. If someone would care to make a motion?
Yes, I also move that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 22, 1989, upon the proposed fiscal year 1990 municipal budget, does hereby finally adopt the municipal budget for the town of Cape Elizabeth for the fiscal year 1990 with a gross expenditure of $12,442,922 and gross resources of $4,336,280, the amount of $8,106,642 to be raised by taxation, and does further fix Thursday, October 5th, 1989, and Friday, May 4th, 1990, as the dates upon each of which one half of such tax is due and payable, with interest to occur upon taxes due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 12% per annum. And the town of Cape Elizabeth votes to accept state foundation allocations, state debt service, and state audit educational revenues as provided by the Maine State Legislature in the amount of $1,875,274.39 in support of schools for the 1989-90 fiscal year. And I would just like to add a comment, and with you accepting this budget, it means an increase similar to last year, approximately 6.9%.
I'll second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the budget put forward in Councilor Jordan's reading. Any further discussion by my fellow councilors on this motion? If not, all those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Passes unanimously 7-0. Before maybe we make any comments, we'll get through all up to item 154. So we'll just keep going with our momentum that we have going here. Item 151, which I'd now like to have a public hearing on, is the sewer fund. Just to summarize, gross expenditures of $1.1 million, gross revenues of approximately the same, $1.068 million. Any discussion from the public on the sewer fund? If not, I would close the public hearing portion and move on to item 151.
I'll make a motion that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 22, 1989, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1990 sewer fund budget with gross expenditures of $1,129,298 and gross revenue of $1,068,340. The deficit in that account, you'll see, will be picked up from the surplus that's been carried over in the sewer fund.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the sewer fund as read. Any further discussion by the council? If not, all those in favor, please raise your hands. Any opposed? Passes unanimously 7-0. We're going to have a public hearing now on item 152, which is the Riverside Cemetery, which has gross expenditures of approximately $10,500, gross revenues of $31,200. Any discussion on the Riverside Cemetery? If not, I close the public hearing portion and move on to item 152.
Mr. Council? Chairman, I make a motion that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 22, 1989, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1990 Riverside Cemetery Trust Fund budget with gross expenditures of $10,500 and gross revenues of $31,200.
Second.
So moved and seconded. All those in favor of item 152 as read? Any opposed? Passes unanimously 7-0. Public hearing now for item 153, which is revolves around the portable classrooms for Cape Elizabeth schools. Basically, it would be authorizing the town council to appropriate $150,000 from undesignated fund surplus balance in order to build these. This is the gist of the motion that would be coming forward. At this time, we'd like to have anyone from the public that wishes to speak on this issue. If not, I'm wearing out my gavel. Oh, sorry. So sorry. quickest gavel in the East.
May I just ask one question in regards to the, I have no objection about the money, but what I'm concerned about is last year we put up a temporary or a portable classroom. This year we're putting up a portable classroom. Are we going to put up another portable classroom next year?
I just want you to hear me.
No, we do not anticipate putting up any other portable classrooms. The portable classrooms we've put up have taken the place of our libraries and our media center. Now that has freed up for us approximately 6 rooms. The best demography we have indicates that we're in pretty good shape for 5 years. We hope we're correct.
So in 5 years, we should consider a building, right?
Well, consider something. Tearing one down or building one, I'm not sure.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sorry about how quick I gaveled. Any other members of the public that would like to speak on item 153, the portable classrooms? If not, I close the public hearing portion and move to 153.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I make a motion that Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 22, 1989, does hereby appropriate $150,000 from the undesignated fund balance for the construction of portable classrooms and authorize the town manager to sign a contract for the construction at an amount not to exceed $150,000 and request appropriation of the lease agreement between the town and the school department for the presentation to the town council at their regular July meeting.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor of item 153 as read, please raise your hand. Any opposed? None opposed.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Before we move on, I'd just like to recognize a gentleman, if I may.
Sir.
That'd be all right with you. Before he ducks out of the room, because he's known to come in late and leave early and what have you. I'd like to recognize Harold Paces for the term on the school board and also the article that was in the Eamon paper. I think it's a very good article, Harold, and I'm on your camp. I take it you have other people that aren't, but I'm on your camp.
Quite a few on the other side.
We now have a public hearing for item 154, which is to consider authorizing the borrowing of $600,000 to fund school improvements and $600,000 to fund roadway and drainage improvements and take any necessary action. A town note for $600,000 for roadway and drainage improvements, a school note for $600,000 for school improvements. Any public discussion on this matter?
You beat the game.
Dude, this time would you like to identify yourself? You've got to identify yourself.
I'm Edmund Capano, and I live on Spurwink Avenue in Cape Elizabeth. May I just ask two questions? What is the annual percentage rate we will be paying on the $600,000?
We're not exactly sure yet. In the last few weeks, interest rates have been falling. We expect a little over 7, somewhere in that range.
A little over 7.
The trend is downward.
And what is our indebtedness now?
I don't know off the top of my head, but it's in the vicinity of $4 million with that mostly all for sewage.
Do we have a borrowing limit, or are we in such a state that we don't have to worry?
The borrowing limit is about 20 times the amount that we currently have borrowed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other members of the public that would like to come forward on item 154?
I'm Frank Potenza, Ivy Road, Cape Elizabeth. Can you explain, maybe generalities, the $600,000 for school improvement and roads and so forth are obvious, but what type of improvements are we talking about for the school system?
I would defer to the superintendent there.
The bulk of that would be for roofs, primarily for roofs that are regularly leaking, and the tennis courts that have to be completely repaired. Now, there are some other items I'd be more than happy to give you a list of. That would be the bulk of the money.
Okay. Aren't these improvements in our new budget that was just approved?
No. I mean, this is a separate bond issue. The payment for the bond in principal and interest is in the budget. Is that right?
That's right.
Okay. I have some back issues of the Cape Coria regarding the 87, 88, and 88, 89 budgets. And there's quite a bit of mention, and I've got them all underlined in red here, about improvements for roofing, 87, 88, 88, 89. And it kept saying that in 87, 88, that if this were done and the money was appropriated, that this would take care of it for a long time. Then in 88, 89, the same thing. Now here we are, 89, 90, talking about roofing repairs. And I wonder how many roofs we have regarding high school, middle school, and so forth. Seems like that's a lot of money for roofing, and we've been going back since 87 talking about roofing repairs. And in the article today that in the Coria that came out today talking about carrying buckets around to get the leaks, taking care of the leaks. But money has been appropriated in 87, 88, 88, 89 for roof repairs, and now we're talking again, 600,000. So it was my understanding last year they had a $500,000 surplus in the school budget. And I understand from a town manager that those monies were put in the general fund. Now, maybe it's too simple, but if the school budget calls for so much and they've got a surplus of a $500,000, why not cut the budget by $500,000? They already have a $500,000 in the desk drawer.
Yes.
I'd like to react to that. First, $300.
Oh, excuse me. Yes.
No, you and I could just step right over there. And I could First of all, we spent $300,000 on capital projects last year. Our problem, sir, is that our roofs are very old. For example, the high school is 17 or 19 years old. Most of the roof of the high school is going to have to be repaired. The $126,000 we're spending this year is on the middle school. The year before that, we spent it on the elementary school. The old high school is 57 years old. That needs a new roof. Water's coming down through. We have, and I need to help on some help in this figure. How many hundred square feet of roof have we projected to repair, D?
This year?
For the next 2 years. we have it. I want you to get this to the square foot.
Ellis has got a 50.
Here we are. There you go. All good. There, that's an acre of roofs to give you some feeling. What are the dimensions of an acre? 44,000 square feet, give or take?
Give or take a little, 42
square feet. We were wrong, sir. 50,000 square feet of roof. That's a lot of roof. We can't do that all in a year. Okay. Anything else?
No, I just...
Thank you.
Curious, that's all. I mean, here's a Coria dated July 2nd, 1988, and they're talking about replacement of roofs. And here's another one in August of 88, talking about repair of roofs, and that if this is done, it should take care of things for about 5 years. So I'm just curious as to how many roofs we had on how many schools. It didn't specify middle or the old high school or the new high school. But
that's the picture. 55,000 square feet.
Okay. I think we all have to be concerned with the fact that a couple of years ago we had a revaluation in this town, and all properties were almost double in valuation, and shorefront properties 3 to 4 times. And the higher the valuation in the town, which is a system in the state of Maine, the higher the valuation, the less we get from the state. And I would think that the council here and the powers to be in any town would really try extremely hard to convince some of our people up in Augusta that they've got to do something to help the towns to offset the property taxes somehow and not look at the valuation. The way things are going, town of Cape Elizabeth is getting the short end because our valuation keeps going up and up. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Michael wanted to make a comment, too. Just in reference to the $500,000 school surplus, last year there was a surplus of approximately $500,000. That was used, it was put into the general fund and then immediately used to reduce the amount from taxes that the school department needed last year. The same thing has been done this year. So in essence, all the surplus that is being generated by the school department is simply being rechanneled in order to reduce the amount being required from taxation. And it's now been done at least 2 years in a row.
Thank you.
Thank you for that clarification. Continuing on with the public hearing for item 154, which regards the school note and the town note. Councilor Jordan, did you want to say something?
Oh, Janet.
Oh,
he's my hand raising.
I'll be next. I yield to the lady, that's all.
Thank you. I just wanted to assure Mr. Vitanzo about the roof situation somewhat. There were some counselors and some school board members took a firsthand tour of the roofs. Now, I don't do ladders, Frank, and I don't do roofs, but they had me climbing ladders and walking on roofs. And from firsthand observation, we have some very poor roofs, badly in need of repair. And we did look at this firsthand. I wanted to assure you of that. I also wanted to let you know that one of the questions brought up in the discussion between the school board and the council in relationship to this bond amount was to verify the fact that money put in the bond for the roofs would in fact be spent exactly on the roofs and not on anything else.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
No, I just want to add a little bit to the superintendent said. I was on a facilities committee here a few years ago, and we don't know the roofs and what have you. And they've been neglected over the years. This is why we didn't, I one personally don't go for this bonding business, but it is one way to keep the taxes reasonable and also to do away with the buckets within the school system, which I think is deplorable in my opinion. And this, we were told at that time there's 200,000 square feet of roofs. You got to do approximately 20,000 a year to get over them once in 10 years. And the high school is approximately 20 years old now, so you got to start on that one, and we're still working on the old ones. So this is one reason why the council really went forward as far as helping, I mean, putting the money available to clean up and straighten out the roofs.
Councilor Amaro.
Yeah, in response to Frank's suggestion that we as councilors should be concerned about talking to our state legislators about property tax relief, Cape Elizabeth is working with the Council of Governments as one of the 21 communities in this area who is advocating in Augusta for, excuse me, for property tax relief for this region. We've joined with the Maine Municipal Association's position and are supporting the legislation which they have brought forward, which offers several programs for property tax relief. So we are very active in seeking some state support for the high property taxes that all of the communities in this area are experiencing. We have to realize, however, that we are also a community that contributes greatly to the income tax that the state collects. And if they look for property tax relief, they may be looking at an increase in the income tax, which is a possibility. But the Maine Municipal Association is proposing an increase in the sales tax. So there are a lot of options that we're working on. Believe me, we're very active in Augusta.
The state of Maine right now is collecting too much tax. I don't know why they're dragging their feet. They have not conformed to the federal. They anticipate over $100 million in excess taxes this year for another refund. And then you find out your refund's taxable, so you're paying taxes twice in some money. So who's giving you this? At any rate, one suggestion might be the tri-state megabucks. Many states now that have
We're continuing on with the public hearing now on items pertinent to item number 154, which is school note 600,000, town note 600,000. Any further discussion on those specific items? If not, I would close the public hearing on item 154 and take up the item, which is Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chairman, I think I will move things along. Instead of reading these two pages, which is involved as far as the voting for these bond issues and all the technicalities that are involved, and move that we adopt the vote per item 154.
I'd second that.
So it has been moved and seconded to adopt item 154 as is in the packet before us. Which I think what we have to have in order, though, is to suspend the rules. A motion to suspend the rules in order to dispense with the reading.
Do you want to read it?
I move that we suspend the rules.
Second.
The movement seconded to suspend the rules to dispense with the reading. And now, Council, your motion is in order.
You want me to repeat?
Your motion. Oh, all those in favor of suspending the rules, I'm sorry. Passes unanimously. Now.
I'll move that we adopt item 154 per regarding the bond issue for road improvements and school improvements for our info in the budget.
Now I'll second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt the authorization of two $600,000 notes, one a town note and one a school note. Yes.
Just a brief explanation of the council. Last week, the bond council gave us a call and was concerned that the school note itself might be considered a major school construction project under the state statutes relating to education. Effective, I believe it was March 1 of 1989, a major school construction project is subject to a referendum by the citizens of a community. The bond council has written a letter to Leroy Nisbet, who is the head of the school construction division of the Department of Education and Cultural Services, asking for a letter in response saying that this would not constitute a major school construction project. A verbal conversation that Dee LaBelle had with Mr. Nisbet indicated that a letter would probably be forthcoming that would say that. It was in terms of when Dee asked him, it wasn't to send a letter, it was in terms of does this require a referendum. And we would expect that letter soon, and just as soon as we receive that, we would expect an unqualified opinion from the bond council. But I did want you to know that an issue could still come up on that, and if Mr. Nisbet is not willing to provide that letter, this might be subject to referendum by the citizens.
Okay, thank you.
Question. Michael, when would that referendum take place then? We are trying to get into the current construction year. Do we have a time period in scheduling a ref?
No, we're 95% certain that a referendum won't be required. I have difficulty answering hypothetical questions, but really, if it did come to a referendum, it would probably end up being November. Because of simply the delay we'd be beyond the construction season if we subsequently did get a letter and had to schedule it this spring or summer. We really at that point would have to wait and have leaky roofs for another season.
So we'll keep our fingers crossed that we get a favorable letter.
We're fairly optimistic.
Any further discussion on item 154? If not, all those in favor, please raise your hands. Any opposed? Passes unanimously, 7-0. I'd like to make a few comments before we move on to item 155. Specifically, I'd like to thank the school committee. I'd like to thank Michael McGovern, our town manager, and Darryl Pelletier, our superintendent, and Dee LaBelle, our municipal controller, as well as all the department heads that participated in this. I hope the public realizes what a real group effort this is. And the underlying feeling of cooperation that ran through all the meetings this year was just outstanding on everybody's part. There was a lot of give and take. There were some real rough edges that we had to get over. But in the long run, I think a real sensitivity to the taxpayers and to the property tax issue this year, not at the expense of what needed to be done in Cape Elizabeth, but still a sensitivity to the taxpayers was throughout from the department head level on down. I think it's a very cost-effective budget, very carefully scrutinized one, that has a plan so that we don't so far run behind on our buildings that we're never able to catch up. I think we have an excellent 5-year plan. The school department is developing one as well. So it was really a business-like manner that we had this budget. And just my personal thanks to everybody involved. It was a pleasure to to work to have this budget, so.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Counselor.
I'd like to add to that, that the council was interested in keeping the rate of increase the same as last year, which was 6.9%. I think that figure was mentioned earlier, but we tried very hard to keep the rate of increase equal to last year's. And in order to do that, we asked the school department to cut $75,000 out of their budget, and we cut $25,000 out of the municipal side. So there was a real effort, Mr. Vitenzo, to recognize the fact that taxpayers are getting a little riled up about increased taxation.
Any further comments before we go into item 155? If not, thank you all once again. And thanks for coming tonight. Item 155 is going to be the next item that we'll take up. But I believe we'll do so in about 60 seconds as the room clears. I'd like to continue on with the town council agenda. Item 155 is to consider authorizing the borrowing of the annual tax anticipation notes and take any necessary action. Counselor
Chairman.
Jordan, do you need any water down there?
No.
Your throat must be.
No, I have asked my colleague to the left if she would like to read this motion, so I will leave it up to her.
Do you want me to make the motion?
Yes.
I would like to move, Mr. Chairman, that pursuant to Section 5771 of Title 30A of the Maine Revised Statutes, the town treasurer is hereby authorized and empowered to borrow money from time to time during the fiscal year ending June 30, 1990, in an amount or amounts not exceeding $1,500,000 at any time outstanding, in anticipation of the collections or receipts from taxes by the issuance of negotiable tax anticipation notes of the town, each of which notes shall be designated tax anticipation note of the fiscal year 1989-1990. All of such tax anticipation notes and any extensions, renewals, or replacements thereof shall be signed by the town treasurer, countersigned by the chairman of the town council, and attested by the town clerk, shall be payable on or before June 30, 1990, out of money raised by taxation, may be issued in non-interest-bearing form and sold on a discount basis, or issued at par and bear interest payable at maturity, and be discounted or bear interest payable at maturity at such rate or rates as may be approved by the treasurer and the chairman of the town council by their execution thereof. All of said tax anticipation notes are hereby designated as, quote, qualified tax exempt obligations within the meaning of Section 265B of the Internal Revenue Code of 1986. And in furtherance of such designation, the treasurer be and hereby is authorized to covenant on behalf of and in the name of the town that the town will not issue in excess of $10 million aggregate principal amount of tax-exempt obligations during calendar year 1989.
Second motion.
Thank you. Moved and seconded to authorize the borrowing of the annual tax anticipation notes. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor? Any opposed? Yes. Frank. Wait, could you come up, please, to the microphone, because people at home.
Not that many people here.
The people, we're televising. We're televising.
I want to see you at home. Very good.
Thank you.
Generally speaking, what is the idea of having the power to borrow this money? Is this in the event of emergencies or contingencies or what?
No, it's to assist with cash flow. Every year, the town treasurer, in our case, the municipal controller, prepares a cash flow schedule. Because we only have taxes due in October and May, there's a period, particularly around March and April, when the town coffers are not exactly flush with money. The arbitrage laws of the federal government allow you to borrow the amount of money that your deficit is the greatest in 1 month, plus your total expenditures of the next month. That amount is still being computed by the municipal controller and is expected to be below $1.5 million. What we do is we borrow it in a lump sum at the beginning of the year. We reinvest it. It ends at the net cost is zero. And in fact, there's a slight profit on it, but since we're within the arbitrage provisions of the federal government, we're allowed to keep that.
Maybe I'm thinking of something else, but wasn't this taken care of a few years ago when the tax payments were changed from calendar year to fiscal? There was really no change, but they just changed the terms. And at one particular year, we had to pay taxes twice to change from a certain date to a certain date because of a cash flow.
In 1976-77, the town changed from a January fiscal year to a July fiscal year, and from a one-year, one-time tax payment to a twice-a-year tax payment. It was felt that would help some with cash flow, but from the very first year, tax anticipation notes were authorized, and they have been authorized each and every year since.
Well, then my thinking was right, that it was done at that time to alleviate a cash flow. Now you're saying that that hasn't been working well since 76-77.
Essentially, yes.
Okay.
Michael, wasn't that also to have our town fiscal year coincide with federal government and state government fiscal years?
That's because, the other reason the changes.
Because of the special programs. So that was one of the major reasons for changing from January to July.
Particularly on the education side, it wasn't much of an issue on the municipal side.
Okay. In the report, wasn't it anticipated that revenues are going to be more this year than last year, property tax?
In the budget?
In the budget, right.
Yes. But even, you know, the taxes that were due on May 5th, there's still, or May 4th, whatever the date was, as of today, there's still $440,000 outstanding. So they're a little slow coming in. And, you know, I think it's prudent for the town to have sufficient funds to pay its bills. And we don't like to read in the newspaper about bounce checks for municipalities.
Are there any properties that have been, the taxes haven't been paid that the town is... can't think of the word, take over the properties?
We have a very aggressive tax collection system. We make full use of liens. The town clerk is currently responsible for that, and we have never had an instance where we've had a problem with tax collection in the long term.
But it's not fair to, for all the people who pay their taxes on time to have a large amount like that unpaid.
The only thing that's truly regrettable is the state sets a limit on the amount of interest we can charge. And for this current year, you may have heard in the councilor's motion, it's only 12%. And meanwhile, people have other debts that they're paying 18% or greater. And the town is not always the first one in line for payment. But our tax collection system is such that eventually payments are received, and we collect 99.99% of all amounts assessed eventually.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to move on to item 156, which is to consider the status of the Stewart property at 10 Manor Way and take any necessary action. And before we make any decisions regarding as a council regarding this issue, I'd like to open this up for public comment. If there's anyone in the audience that would care to come forward to speak in any way about item 156, now would be an appropriate time to do so. Seeing none, I will ask, oh, I'm sorry.
My name is Paul Stewart. I guess what I have to do is plead mercy of the town council. We have put into action a verbal commitment from some lenders in Massachusetts to finish that project. They've approved me for $150,000 loan plus closing costs, which would be any liens and outstanding debts that are on that property. And what we're trying to do is complete that project and sell it and get back the investment that I have in it, which is my total life earnings. I've been going through this process for 2 weeks trying to get this totally lined up. They have not come across, to my knowledge, with a letter of commitment. I have a mortgage broker in Wiscasset, Don Shields, with F&L Associates, who is willing to form a limited partnership with me to create the security that you need so that we can complete this project. I'm within days of closing if you will release the title. And that's about where it sits right now. It's in your hands.
Thank you. There has been a suggestion made to...
What?
Anyone else from the public? Okay. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is John Delahanty. I live at 11 Manor Way. I'm also president of the Belfield Association, which is the homeowners association for the Cranbrook development. And I believe that in April, Matt Karras represented the association due to my inability to be here. I think at that time, there was probably a great deal of discussion with regard to this property. I know that members of the council have viewed the property. I believe that Mr. Stewart met with the town manager and the town council, SEL, Mr. Leahy, to discuss certain requirements to be met. The driveway has been bulldozed, and material, the appliances that were outside the house, for the most part, have been put in. Some are still outside, but that's a minor detail. I don't like to stand here to be a curmudgeon or to be a person who is seeking to bring hardship upon someone else. We recognize that Mr. Stewart has expressed an inability to finish a house over the past several years due to personal circumstances. We think that the neighbors have certainly been accepting of many of those explanations. Unfortunately, every explanation which he has come forward with always seems to have gone by the wayside. I know personally of at least three offers which had previously been made on the property. On behalf of the association, we hope that you take every consideration with this property and deal with it as you feel appropriate. You know, the laws with regard to collection of taxes are put on the books for certain reasons, and the property is now in the town's hands. Frankly, and I know I speak for my neighbors as well as other association members, given the past history with this project, we are skeptical that the property indeed will be completed in a fashion commensurate with the ability to sell it. The structure has been standing for several years. We're concerned that with the quality of the construction that might be finished, we believe the best course would be for the town to provide that Mr. Stewart attempt to sell this property between now and some point this summer, and failing that, that the town then go on to sell it. I think that Mr. Stewart has certainly had every opportunity to try to arrange the financing by this point. And I know you face a difficult decision, but I did want to speak as to the wishes of the association. And I'd be glad to answer any questions if you have some. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there other members of the public that wish to speak on item 156 regarding the Stewart property? If not, I would like to open it up to the council. Yes.
Before the council takes any action, I'd like to ask to be excused from voting on this item because of possible harm.
Is it a consensus? Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I also would ask to be relieved of the responsibility of voting and discussing this item because of a possible conflict.
Consensus
for
on both?
I consent. Consent.
She consents. That means there's mutual consensus, or consensi, as it were. I don't know the proper Latin on that, but nonetheless, item 156 is with us. And did you want to?
I have this letter that has been faxed from Methanol Associates.
Hey, could you go to the microphone? I'm sorry.
I have this letter that's been faxed to Mr. Leahy, who's the town's attorney, concerning the loan. In reference to Paul Stewart and his Cape Elizabeth building project, I'm willing to become Paul's partner in the house construction project in Cape Elizabeth. I have a verbal agreement from P&M Associates of Newton, Massachusetts for $150,000 construction loan to complete the Cape Elizabeth house. P&M would not issue a letter of commitment until the property was transferred from the town of Cape Elizabeth back to Paul Stewart. I work and live in Wiscasset, operate a Cannon Town outlet, as well as a bookkeeping and tax practice and a loan brokerage business. I know there has been problems with Paul and the town of Cape Elizabeth, and if I could have been involved sooner, this would have never happened. I hope the town of Cape Elizabeth will reconsider and let Mr. Stewart and myself complete the construction of this house. Thank you. Donald Shields, FNL Associates. As far as the question of the construction, the quality of the construction, P&M Associates has sent up a structural engineer to verify that the quality of the construction as it stands is perfectly fine, and that the $150,000 in our estimate between my subcontractors and P&M Associates, they feel that the house will be of equal, if not better quality than the adjoining houses in that project. We're looking to finish the project for the betterment of Cranbrook, Belfield Associates, as well as the town. I've had personal problems, financial problems, but it appears that this commitment by these people in Newton would allow this to be completed. I hope you value that commitment. Thank you.
When would you say that the verbal commitment would become consummated in a written commitment? I mean, what type of a time frame do you feel is reasonable that a verbal
They told me that if I had the title in my hands that we could close by the end of the week. I've already had the research done on clearing title, finding out what liens are on it. The minute they have that, we've sent down building permits, estimates, everything is in place. I've got my subcontractors lined up. All the commitments that you have set forth, we're willing to complete with. You want it done by August 1st as an occupancy permit, we think we can get it done before that. I have no illusions that I have been bogged down by personal problems that have not allowed me to complete this project.
I feel that this second chance will allow me to do that.
Thank you. Council Greenlaw?
Mr. Stewart, through the chair. You're saying that you expect to be able to meet or better the suggested deadline of a certificate of occupancy by August 1st.
That's correct.
One of the other conditions was satisfactory evidence of a commitment for financing of both the health and landscaping by May 15th. I just want that on the record because I have not seen that
yet.
Well,
that's what this letter alludes to.
It alludes, but it is not an
it's
explicit.
It's a verbal commitment. Yeah. I have been approved for the loan. They're waiting for the title.
Okay.
I mean, if we could structure something where you feel secure, let us go 2 weeks, give me the title, let us get the loan. If nothing happens within 2 weeks, take the property. You know, I don't know what kind of legal document you could draw up that would give you the security. I know the money is there.
How feasible do you, in your gut, feel that it is to have all the exterior work done by July 1st?
My subcontractors feel there's no problem. We're going to put four men or more on the crew right off the bat. They're just sitting and waiting for this to happen. The minute everything clears up, we've got money to rock and roll with. I mean, there's no question. I've lined up all the subs.
Okay.
We've got the electricians, the plumbers, the exterior people. We've got interior people ready to roll with the project. We're just waiting. The
okay.
money is there.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Any other questions, Mr. Stewart?
No, but I have a question about the town attorney that I'd like to ask for his legal opinion with regard to if we do vote to return the title to Mr. Stewart, where does that put us in a situation if something, you know, falls through again in terms of the legal aspects of where, you know, we can move, that sort of thing?
Mr. Grillman, you would not be as secured as you are today. You have title today, tax-acquired title, and that is what you could convey to another party, presumably, and have that person complete the house. You would still have whatever remedies you have always had to rectify a nuisance, to take the action municipally or in court to address a new nuisance that's been invoked before, that was threatened in this case. You can secure the building, a dangerous building, under that scenario. You can't complete a building to the degree we're talking about of houses in Cranbrook. Specific question, I think there is a problem because, as I hear Mr. Stewart, his lender says they would require that they have the title, or that Mr. Stewart have the title. That, if you will, is the tool, the leverage that this town has to deal with that property at this time. If the title was transferred, you would not have that. Possibly we could contract with Mr. Stewart, authorize a manager or somebody enter a contract with Mr. Stewart saying that he shall do this by this date and this by another. Should he fail to do that, he would not have the mechanism of transferring your title. You would have the ability to go to court and sue. It would not be as quick a remedy available to you. I do a fair amount of commercial work, and it seems an unusual standard or step for them to require title. Oftentimes, if there's a commitment for financing, the financing can be conditioned upon certain things happening. What we suggested earlier in our letter to Mrs. Stewart was that if he came to that point, had a commitment for financing, and the only problem was the title, that so long as the town was secured, say by a letter of credit or a performance bond, that would secure to the town the completion of improvements by a certain date, that could take the place, if you will, of our tax title now. That could secure the town. An independent bona fide lender issuing a security, a letter of credit, or town that they could draw, the town could draw upon if it were not completed by a certain date. That is what I propose as what the town may accept to give up its tax title to allow him to get a construction loan, to pay the liens, pay the taxes, and get the work done. So far, that lender has not provided a letter satisfactory to the town. It has not provided a letter at all. So I don't know if they would accept that. That has been, from my point of view, on the table since this time. As far as the options, again, I can go through them, or suggest that we go into executive session if that's the will.
I was going to mention, before we get any further along, it has been suggested that we, because of the many financial and legal ramifications of this, that we go into executive session with this. And we also have a few items at the end of our agenda that we would need to go into executive session with. So if it were the will of the council to do so, then come out of executive session to dispose of this matter, we could table this now till the end of our meeting, at which point we would put all of the things that we're going to do in executive session together. So if people would like to do so, I'd like to hear a motion on that.
Counselor? Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I would like to ask one question, and I'll make that as a motion. And I think, if I may, direct it to Mr. Stewart. But the part that bothers me, is that the complete loan, $150,000?
No, if they told me that if I needed more, I could get as much as up to $275,000.
Up to $275,000?
That's correct.
Because as I read this, to me, I don't know exactly what he owes the town. And if we go the route the town attorney has outline, which if we do anything, I feel the town should be really secured in any way possible. I'm not losing their grip on it.
I agree totally.
And the 150 seemed to be low to me, so I would think that we would want a little bit more on paper than 150,000. That'd be my opinion. So I'll move that we go into executive session, take this
table.
Up at
no,
the end
table.
Of the
you move to table.
Can we table this?
Table it.
Till the end of the meeting.
Till the end of the meeting, okay.
Then. Second.
All right, been moved and seconded to table item 156 to the end of our meeting. All those in favor? Any opposed? It passes unanimously 5-0. Item 157 is to consider authorizing a special sewer assessment in order to collect an unpaid sewer connection fee and take any necessary action. Michael?
Yes, we ran into a problem with the collection of a payment of a sewer connection fee. In front of you on the podium this evening is a proposed sewer connection assessment. Unfortunately, it's difficult for a municipality to make collection unless we go through a formal assessment process. And I would hope that perhaps you could suspend the rules and with the reading of this and adopt it in order that we could perfect our collection process.
Very good. Anyone care to move to suspend the rules such
so moved.
To dispense with the
second.
Reading? Been moved and seconded. All those in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously 7-0. Someone like to then make the motion?
We don't have to read, just
a summary of it then. Move to adopt it.
Move to adopt the, I move to adopt the sewer connection assessment as presented this evening.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion by the council? All those in favor? Any opposed? Passes 7-0. Okay, moving on to item number 158, we have the consideration of revised Spurwink Church regulations and taking any necessary action. Michael?
During the budget process, the Finance Committee was concerned that we may not be collecting a sufficient amount for parking for an attendant after hours at Spurwink Church on Saturday or on Sunday. So what I've done is looked at the cost for that, the hourly minimums, and particularly for calling someone in on Sunday, and proposed that the charge for parking after 4 p.m. and on Sundays be changed from the current $20 to $50. That includes the full cost, including benefits. And in addition to that, while we were looking at this, possible two provisions. One is that if there's a cancellation, it would result in forfeiture of the security deposit. We have a number of cases where people reserve the church with really no full intent of using it, and as a result, It just isn't available for other people to use, and a lot of people are very, very disappointed when they can't use the church. So I would suggest that you have that as a provision under the security deposit section. Third, we've been having problems with receiving lines taking place out on the front lawn. It's a very dangerous situation out there because of the intersections of Spurwink Avenue, Bowery Beach Road, Route 77. With traffic on both sides, with kids running around, particularly if you get a large-sized group, they tend to mingle there, and it's somewhat dangerous. So I would recommend that you amend the Spurwink Church use provisions to include those three additions.
Thank you, Michael. Any discussion? Yes.
I have a question. This is $50 per wedding?
For the security deposit?
For the number one?
No, for the parking.
Yes.
For the parking, and that means a policeman. Does that mean?
Or a public works personnel.
To sort of direct parking and so forth.
Policeman would be $80, actually.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Greenlaw.
I have a question on the security deposit. What kind of thought was given to putting a time frame on that? That if you canceled within, given so many weeks before, you would not lose a deposit. If you canceled after that, you wouldn't lose it.
It was looked at, but the problem is we reserved beginning last year for this year. And you have people calling in January who were telling that a date in September is unavailable. Mm-hmm. So, you can come up with a date, but it really doesn't solve the problem of the person who was denied access because someone, just wanted to try to keep every option open without any penalty.
How far ahead do we take reservations?
It used to be January 1st, but what we were finding was that a lot of people do schedule weddings a year ahead, and it's for those of you that have scheduled weddings, it's very difficult to get the reception lined up, the church lined up, the minister or the justice of the peace lined up, the band, all those things. I'm not experienced in this area, but
you sound it.
Sound like you're planning.
But regardless,
you get cold feet once.
No,
tell
no.
us now. No one's listening.
Okay. No, regardless, it's very difficult to schedule weddings and to get everything in line. And did I answer the question?
Thank you.
I think you stumbled along far enough. Thank you.
Further discussion.
Yes. Is this fee for a regular town employee or is it a part-time employee?
Well, right now we're using a temporary service because the person we hired backed off on coming, so we're having to re-advertise the position of the Riverside Cemetery attendant. It is the person who's at Riverside Cemetery, is the one who does
during
it.
The summer.
Yeah.
So he has benefits and whatever.
Yeah. Well, it's right now the pay is about six. It's $6 an hour, and by the time you add on the benefits and all that, it creeps up. We don't pay, of course, retirement, but we do a Social Security, workers' comp, et cetera.
I want you making money on it, that's all.
We're making a little bit.
I would like to say that I am going to, with a heavy heart, vote in favor of this because my receiving line was outside, and it was one of the most memorable points of my very memorable wedding. As you can imagine, it lasted 3.5 hours, also, my receiving line, but I can understand due to safety problems that we cannot have it outside.
We also have beautiful grass over there now, too, which is not a major factor. But
to have the sun shining down. Good for the videos, too, Michael, when it's outside. But nonetheless.
Was your receiving line out front or out back?
Out and back.
Okay, thank you.
Took up the whole parking lot. It was amazing. Yes, Councilor.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt the revised Spurwink Church regulations.
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed? 7-0. Item number 159 is daycare lease. Michael.
Another area I don't have too much experience in. Nonetheless, the Cape Elizabeth, the South Portland Church of the Nazarene for, it must be about 4 to 5 years now, has been leasing one of our buildings at Fort Williams Park. There's been steady increases in the lease amount. In the earlier years, it was 10 to 20% increase in trying to get it more up with the market rate. It last year and this year, I think we've taken a slightly different approach, and to look at, to make sure we're paying the cost of it, but also recognizing that there is a definite need for daycare in the community, and that this particular daycare center does provide a very needed service. They have asked for the lease to be extended from 12 months to 13 months, which brings it from a June 1 expiration date to July 1. That's to, in order to coincide with the school year. Beyond that, it's proposed that the monthly rent go from 5.25 to 5.50 per month. In addition, the church is required to pay the heat and utilities and all the various expenses. So I would recommend that you authorize me to sign this proposed lease agreement.
So move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor?
In that so move motion there, do you authorize the manager to sign the agreement?
Yes.
Is that
yes.
what you
mm-hmm.
intended? Okay. Okay.
Okay. All those in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. 7-0. Before we entertain a motion to go into executive session, we have citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda, part two. Anybody care to come forward at this time? Because it is a rich tradition in Cape Elizabeth to have it at the beginning and the end, I'm going to follow through. Would anyone like to come forward to discuss items not on the agenda? Yes.
I usually take my Ed Capano, Spurling Academy. Yeah. I usually take my walks through the cemetery during the daytime. This year I noticed, I believe it's Linden Lane, there are about 6 or 7 trees that I'm very concerned about. They're beautiful trees, but I have observed splitting in the trunks. And I would like to think that maybe the tree warden would take a look at those, because if we could save them, it would be worth the effort. Otherwise, I'm almost sure we're going to lose them, because the splits in some of them are quite severe, and you can see where they're healing over. But the minute the bugs start getting into those cracks, we're going to lose those trees. So I just bring that to your attention to see if we can do something about it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Do you know what kind of trees they are, Ed?
Maples. Maples.
Are they sugar maple?
I believe they're all probably a Japanese maple.
Are they mature trees?
No. I'd say maximum age probably, well, when did Ed Cooper do this?
Yeah. 10 years.
They're probably 10 or 15 years old. Some seem to appear to have grown too fast, so fast that they just split. And now I notice that some of the smaller ones, 2.5 to 3 inches in diameter, are showing the same wear and tear. I don't know if it's the type of tree. I don't know if it's the wind blowing off the marsh that's creating a real freezing problem, and then an expansion, and whatever the case may be. But maybe someone with a little bit more expertise than I have might possibly look at those, because it really is a shame. Those trees were just coming along beautiful, and I just love to watch them, you know. And particularly watch the birds build nests, you know. That's a lot of fun. I have to look at everything when I go through. But it's something that I think we ought to look into.
Ice in the wintertime causes it.
Probably, yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm almost sure that's what you mean. I'm not an expert.
Thank you, Ed, very much for pointing that out. Appreciate it. Any other citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda? If not, before we entertain the motion for executive session, I'd like to have one brief community reminder that tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. at the lecture hall at Cape Elizabeth High School, the Senate Majority Leader of the United States Senate, George Mitchell, will be holding a very more or less informal public hearing, and I certainly hope that a lot of Cape residents can get there and get there early, because I'm sure it's going to be very well attended. It starts at 7 p.m. at the lecture hall at Cape Elizabeth High School.
Will be taped for later broadcast. As well.
Taped for later broadcast. A strictly nonpartisan announcement that was. Just a note of community interest. Would someone care to make a motion to enter executive session?
So moved.
Second.
to discuss item 156 and other pending litigation.
You should state the precise nature of why you're going in.
So that is the precise nature of why we're going in.
One thing I'd like to point out before we go into executive session there, it might be longer than you think. TV people going to have to stay around till we come out and...
Yes.
Sorry, couldn't go home.
What you probably want to do is discuss the Stewart thing first and come back and then adjourn and do that in a workshop.
See you at 12.
Yeah. Can we do that?
Yes.
Okay, it has been suggested that we will discuss the Stewart matter, then come out of executive session to complete that matter, and then return to executive session. Because there'll be no further business coming after that, so there'll be no need for the camera people to have to stay. So we will just be discussing one, coming back, and then going back into executive session, then going right to adjournment. So thus what we're doing now is entering executive session to discuss item 156 only.
The disposition of public property.
The disposition.
Of public property.
Of public property.
All in favor?
All in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously.
You two girls can have coffee. Save me
the
cup.
We will be back on the air.
Do we need anything in particular on the ladder?
I think a conference room opened up.
Maybe you girls could keep the TV camera going.
Oh, could you?
Is that mean speak?
Securing to the town the completion of the house by August 1st, 1989, to include all interior work and all exterior work, garage, and landscaping. Four, such other conditions as a town attorney may deem appropriate, not inconsistent with the above conditions. If Mr. Stewart shall fail to meet any of those conditions by June 5th, 1989, and the town will retain its tax-acquired title and may then proceed to dispose of the property by sealed bid.
So,
yes.
I move that we adopt that.
Second.
As outlined by the town attorney.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Any discussion from the public? All those in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously, 5-0. I would now entertain a motion that we re-enter executive session for the purpose of discussing with the town attorney some pending litigation that we have regarding the Maxwell Farm Stand case, the Plummer Eastfield case, and the Davis Wetland case.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Been moved and seconded to return to executive session. Being that there is no pending action from any of these three, that we are merely being updated, what we will do is come out of executive session and immediately adjourn. So I just wanted to let the members of the public be aware of that. All those in favor of entering executive session? Any opposed? Passes unanimously, 7-0. So we will return again. With no cameras. You will not return at home. Good night.